Hello everyone. First of all, I would like to thank you all for attending this presentation. I am Sarthak Chakravorty, an undergraduate student at the Indian Institute of Technology Kharagpur, and I am going to present to you our work titled Parima Viewport Adaptive 360 Degree Video Stream. First question that comes to our mind is, what is a 360 degree video? As shown in the video clip on the top left corner, it can capture the view in every direction at the same time. The clip shows an equirectangular projection of the video where we can see the entire frame having an omnidirectional view of the scene. However, we can see on the video clip on the bottom right corner that only a portion of the entire frame is visible, which is called the viewport. A person watching a 360 degree video can only see the viewport and the remaining portion of the frame is not viewed at all. While streaming, if you stream the entire video in high quality, it would result in a huge amount of wastage of bandwidth. Thus, the main goal of adaptivity is whether we can predict what the viewport of a user can be before downloading it from the server. In such a case, we can download only the viewport at a high quality, which would reduce the bandwidth wastage. Now, we shall dive into more concrete formulation of the problem and explain our solution. Recently, 360 degree videos has come to great popularity in academics as well as industry due to its immersing and fascinating experience. It is used in panoramic photography, robotics, VR, healthcare applications, military applications, and is also used by common streaming platforms like Facebook, YouTube, etc. However, streaming 360 degree videos poses a variety of challenges. Roughly only 25% of the full frame size is viewed by a user at a moment, as we have seen earlier. Hence, delivering the full frame in high bitrate might result in a wastage of a huge amount of bandwidth. Secondly, predicting viewports is often a CPU and memory intensive task, and the algorithm should also have a short response time. This would decrease buffering and improve the quality of experience or QoE. So, motivated by these challenges, we try to predict the future viewport of the frames beforehand in a robust manner and assign higher bitrate to these predicted viewports. Our central claim is that the viewport of a user watching a 360-degree video depends on his previous viewport as well as on the trajectories of the prime objects in the video, which we shall justify further. There have been some previous researches on viewport prediction. They involve using varying methods like regression models, clustering user viewports, reinforcement learning-based prediction, or using saliency maps to denote user gazes and predict the future viewing probability. However, they suffer from at least one of these shortcomings. They either use large number of parameters, which is compute expensive to predict, or the model does not dynamically adapt to user movements during a video, or does not use video contents to predict viewports, or are not easily extendable to new videos, or in some cases, not even suitable from a streaming perspective. In this work, we aim to overcome these shortcomings and develop a new model named Parima, which is an augmentation of Arima time series model and passive aggressive regression. It dynamically adapts to user movements, has low prediction time, uses video contents along with previous user head movements, and is easily extendable to new videos, requiring just a one-time pre-processing at the server side. We should be first familiar with a few terminologies. As discussed earlier, viewport is the portion of the frame that is in the field of view of the user, as we see in this diagram. The total length of 360-degree video is divided into several temporal segments, which is termed as chunks. Hence, each chunk contains multiple frames, and the total duration of a chunk is called the chunk size. Usually, one chunk is streamed at definite intervals. Within each chunk, each frame is further divided into spatial segments called tiles, which are illustrated in this diagram. Now, let's look at the complete working of a system as a whole. A one-time video pre-processing is done in the beginning at the server side, and the metadata of the video content and the object trajectories are stored. The server can then send the object trajectory information and a few initial frames to the client, which is rendered at the client side. The client uses a head mounting device to watch the video, which can record the head tracking logs. Using the user head movement logs and the metadata sent by the server, the client then runs a viewport prediction model for some of the future frames and allocates appropriate bitrates to each tile. The bitrate information for each tile within a chunk is then communicated back to the server. The server can then send the corresponding frames at a particular bitrate, and this process continues. Hence, the major tasks are video pre-processing, viewport prediction, and bitrate allocation, which we have developed in our work. So the first component is video pre-processing, which is done to extract the object trajectories from the video, which we use as a representative for video contents. The most common representation of 360-degree video is the equirectangular projection, but we cannot directly run object detection on it since the objects may be distorted. Hence, we transform the equirectangular projection to cube map projection, where the frame is represented on six faces of the cube. However, some objects might span across multiple faces of the cube, and an object detection algorithm on each face individually can result in faulty outputs. Thus, we stitch the frames of the cube to form a single less distorted projection of the frame. We then use YOLO V3 object detection algorithm on the stitched frame. The objects detected can be seen enclosed in green rectangles. The frame is then reprojected back to equirectangular format for object tracking. Now, we will assign unique IDs to each object and track their centroids to obtain the object trajectories. However, objects can wrap around from the right side of the frame to the left or vice versa because of the property of 360-degree videos. Thus, we will track the distance between the centroids in their spherical projection. Here is an illustration. The triangular marking denotes the centroids of the objects in previous frame, referred to as active objects. And the green rectangles are the objects detected in the current frame, and green dots are their centroids. As earlier said, we project the frame in spherical domain and calculate the solid angle distance between the centroids of the current objects and the active objects and create a mapping. Current objects are then labeled with the corresponding ID of active objects, and the centroids are noted. Nuances involving an object disappearing for a certain number of frames are handled in the algorithm mentioned in the paper. Thus, for each object, we obtain a set of coordinates of their centroids in each frame till it remains active. That denotes its object trajectory, which we store as a metadata. Now, our next task is viewport prediction. Here is a schematic representation of the PARIMA model, an augmentation of ARIMA time series model and passive-aggressive regression. It takes object trajectories and user viewports for a chunk of frames as an input to predict viewports for the next chunk of frames. We will now discuss each component of our model in detail. The first component is to adjust the width. Since we will be using a time series model, we would need our input to be continuous. However, as you can see in the diagram, let the user move their gaze from the right side of the frame to the left as marked by green dots. This would result in a discontinuous series of coordinate values. Hence, to make it continuous, we shift the coordinates by plus minus width of the frame accordingly, as we have shown in the diagram, where we shift some of the user gaze by plus width. With continuous head movement coordinates for the previous chunk of frames as input, we use two separate ARIMA time series models, one each for x and y coordinate, to predict the viewport coordinates for next chunk of frames, as has been shown in this diagram. We transform the domain of the viewport coordinates to logarithmic domain to maintain the stationarity of the time series before employing ARIMA. Predictions from ARIMA are then restored back to the coordinate domain by simple exponentiation. Thus, we obtain the intermediate prediction of viewports for the next chunk of frames. Using the intermediate viewports predicted by ARIMA and the object trajectories of the same set of frames, we use peer regression model to predict the final set of viewports using the following regression equations. Final predictions are obtained by adjusting the width to counter the shift that we had done in the beginning. Details of the algorithm is documented in the paper. When we get the actual viewport viewed by the user, we use it to calculate the loss and train the passive-aggressive model. As a next task, we need to allocate bitrates to the tiles of the chunk. We employ a pyramidal scheme to allocate bitrate. That is, each tile gets a certain weight, and the weight decreases gradually as one moves away from the predicted viewport, in order to maintain the quality of experience for the user. The algorithm shown assigns higher weight and hence bitrate to the tiles within the viewport, and the remaining tiles gets weight depending on how far they are from the viewport based on minimum Manhattan distance. Minimum Manhattan distance refers to the minimum distance after considering all the wrapping around property of an equirectangular frame. We have made subtle changes to give more weightage to the tiles within the video player field of view than the others, which is discussed in the paper. Now, coming to our evaluation portion, we first discuss the test bit. We have used two popular data sets, one having 5 videos watched over by 59 users, while the other having 9 videos watched over by 48 users. We have used PanoSalNet, Clust, and Naba as our baselines, details of which are in the paper. To measure accuracy of our prediction model, we have used minimum Manhattan distance between the actual tile and the predicted tile of the viewport averaged over the video length. For QoE measurements, we have used four metrics. Q1 is the average bitrate consumed by the user, denoting the quality that the user perceives. Q2 denotes the variation of bitrate within the viewport of each frame, that is the variation in bitrate allocated to the tiles within the viewport. Q3 denotes the variation of bitrate among the frames within a single chunk. And finally, Q4 is the variation of bitrate across successive chunks. The equation for the total QoE is given by weighted sum of QoE measures with weights +1, -1, -1, and -1 respectively for Q1, Q2, Q3, and Q4, which are summed over all chunks. First, we will evaluate the optimal chunk size. We plot the QoE with respect to chunk size duration, where we use 0.5 second, 1 second, 1.5 second, and 2 second as a chunk size. We see that QoE steadily decreases and with increasing chunk size, which is expected since a larger chunk size would imply lesser adaptiveness of the model and hence lesser QoE. However, we shall not use 0.5 second in our experiments. This is because, as we see in the above plot, that the total streaming time might exceed the chunk duration because of network delay and prediction time, which might result in buffering. However, the total streaming time is comfortably under 1 second for a 1 second chunk, and hence we use the same in our further experiments. Next, our experimentation tries to show the enhancement of PARIMA over ARIMA and PA model employed individually. We see in the plot on the right that QoE for PARIMA is higher than both ARIMA and PA models. Similarly, on the left, we see that the tile error for PARIMA is the least, thus showing that the augmentation of the two models has indeed enhanced our prediction. Thirdly, we will establish that object trajectories form an essential part in viewport prediction. Final prediction of the viewport is a regression equation as shown, which takes intermediate viewports from ARIMA model and object trajectories into account. Thus, object contribution is defined as the ratio of the importance of the object trajectory in final prediction over the final predicted viewport, which we plot as a percentage. The red portion indicates the object contribution, while the blue portion indicates the contribution of previous viewport. We find that on an average, around 34% or one-third of the predicted weight is given to the object contribution in final prediction, which is a significant amount, thus establishing our initial claim. Finally, we show the enhancement in QoE of PARIMA that we get over the other baselines of PanoSalNet, CLUST, and NABA. We see that PARIMA outperforms all the baselines in the videos. CLUST reaches close to PARIMA for videos in DS2, since it clusters user viewports and hence will perform better for the videos, which is more object-centric, such that there will be higher concentration of user gaze on the objects. PanoSalNet uses saliency maps and their methodology does not dynamically adapt to user changes during a video and hence has lower QoE. NABA is expected to exhibit the least QoE because it employs non-adaptive bitrate to the tiles. Similarly, PARIMA also exhibits lower tile error over other baselines as depicted in the table. Thus, PARIMA outperforms the other baselines in our experimentation strategy. Thus, as a conclusion, we have developed a novel tile-based viewport prediction model, PARIMA, which takes into account the object trajectories as a representative of video content in viewport prediction. We have used pyramid-based bitrate allocation mechanism to assign higher bitrate to the predicted viewport. By our experiments, we have shown that 1 second chunk is optimal for video streaming, and PARIMA exhibits better QoE than other baselines. Thank you.